What do you do when you're experiencing symptoms of colorectal cancer? Does that mean that you've got cancer? Are there some symptoms that are more serious than others? I get asked questions all the time from people on my channel that are experiencing changes in their bowel habits, wondering if what they're experiencing means they have cancer. Well, I'm not a doctor and I can't see inside of your colon to tell you whether or not you have cancer, but I can help you figure out what the next steps are that you should do. How do I know? Well, my name is Jelena, and I was diagnosed with stage 3 rectal cancer in 2016 at the age of 34. Since treatment has ended, I've become involved in advocacy and have made it my goal to spread awareness for this disease, which is now the number 2 cancer killer in the United States. To keep up with what I'm doing in between my YouTube videos, you can follow me on my Facebook page called Life as a Cancer Survivor. You could follow me over on Instagram. My username there is colorado.jelena. Or on Twitter, you can follow me at survivor_jelena. The links to all of those are in the description below, so you can just click on those to get you taken right to my profile so you can follow me. Now let's talk about what you're here for. What do you do when you're experiencing symptoms of colorectal cancer? Well, first, let me list for you what the most common symptoms are. Blood, either bright red or very dark in the stool. Diarrhea, constipation, or feeling that the bowel doesn't completely empty. Stools that are narrower than usual. Frequent gas pains, bloating, fullness, or cramps. Weight loss for no known reason. And feeling very tired and weak. Let me also note that sometimes there are no symptoms at all, especially if the cancer is in early stages. So that's why it's really important that if you're 45 or older, that you make sure that you're up to date with your screening. Now, let's say you're either up to date with your screening or you're under the age of 45 and you're experiencing symptoms. Now what? First thing you need to do is write down your symptom. Either write it down on a piece of paper or start a new note in your phone to keep track of it. Start the note with the date, the symptom, how severe it is, and details of the symptom. For example, write down today's date, diarrhea, and how many times that you had to go that day. It's also helpful if you can list out the things that you ate that day as well. You can also use an app to keep track of your food intake and symptoms. I like using the app My Symptoms because I feel like it gives me the ability to track the most details, and it also gives you the options for you to be able to download that information and even print it out so that you could take it to the doctor if you needed to. Keeping track of your food plus your symptoms is really helpful because sometimes the food that we eat can change what our bowel habits look like. So you want to make sure that it just isn't something that you ate that's causing these changes. Now that you've started tracking, it's time to take a look and make sure that it's not something that you've eaten that's causing these troubles. For example, if you're experiencing constipation, is it because maybe you haven't been eating a whole lot of fiber recently? Try increasing your fiber and your water intake for a few days to see if that can help resolve the problem at all. If making changes to your diet doesn't alleviate the problem after a week or two, you at least have data that you can bring to your doctor's appointment to show that you've tried to help this and changes in your diet haven't worked. And yes, you should be patient and wait a week or two because it can take a couple of days, especially if you're constipated, for that to work its way out. And then your digestive system needs to recover from that incident. Other things that can be helpful to track as well are how much sleep you're getting, stress you're experiencing, and exercise that you're doing. All of these also can be easily tracked in that My Symptoms app with just a couple of taps of your finger. The next thing that you should do is talk with your family. Find out if you have any kind of family history of any digestive diseases, such as Crohn's or celiac. Find out if anybody has had a polyp removed during a colonoscopy or if anyone has been diagnosed with colorectal cancer. These are really important pieces of information to talk to your doctor about, and they can put you at a greater risk of being diagnosed with colorectal cancer. If an immediate family member has been diagnosed, you should be screened 10 years prior to the age that they were diagnosed. So, for example, I was diagnosed at age 34. I have a daughter, and she's going to need to go in for her first screening colonoscopy at age 24. Sorry, kid. If you do happen to have a family history, but you're not quite yet at the age where you should be screened, telling your doctor about that family history should hopefully help them take your symptoms a little more seriously and let them be a little bit more eager to screen you for colorectal cancer. Now, if your symptoms have persisted for 4 to 6 weeks, even though you've made changes to your diet and/or your daily activities, it's time to take further action. Now it's time to give your doctor's office a call to set up an appointment to see them. You should start out with just your regular doctor, also known as a general practitioner or a GP. I don't know about you, but my doctor's office, she's usually booked up weeks, sometimes months in advance. So I will typically go in and see the nurse practitioner, and that's totally fine. It was actually a nurse practitioner that referred me to get my colonoscopy because that was the person in the office that I could get in to see the fastest. When you go in for your appointment, they're going to want to know what symptoms you've been experiencing, how long you've been experiencing them, and how severe they've been. This is where the tracking really comes in handy. You can either print out the data to bring it with you, or make sure that you've got some kind of summary that you can easily access on your phone and show the doctor or nurse practitioner without having to do a lot of swiping. Bringing in that data will be great information for the doctor, but it will also show them that the symptoms you're experiencing are something to be taken seriously, and it's not just a tummy ache or a bad poop day that brought you into this visit. Now, it's really important to keep in mind that the symptoms for colorectal cancer are also very similar to symptoms of other gastrointestinal issues. So just because you're experiencing these doesn't mean that you have cancer. You won't know, though, until you go into the doctor and you find out what is causing these symptoms. Don't let fear of thinking that you may have cancer keep you from going in to see the doctor and get that diagnosis. Because if you do have cancer, it's not gonna go away just because you don't go into the doctor. Get to the doctor so that you can get to the bottom of what's going on and you can start treatment or start working on solutions to fix these symptoms. When my rectal bleeding returned for the third time and I went in to see the nurse practitioner in my office, she first sent me in to get my blood drawn and tested for a bunch of different food allergies, and then she also had me go on a gluten-free diet. When the food allergy tests all came back negative and the gluten-free diet didn't stop the bleeding or the diarrhea I was experiencing, then she referred me to get a colonoscopy. Want to know what it's like to get a colonoscopy? Click up here and that'll take you to the vlog that I did for my most recent colonoscopy. I take you through what I ate for the couple of days leading up to it, what it's like once you get to the facility, and what the recovery was like afterwards. As I mentioned in my experience, a colonoscopy may not be the very first thing that the doctor recommends, and that's okay. Let them run the less invasive tests first to rule out something that's less serious that could be causing these symptoms. What's important is that you and your doctor have a plan. When I went in, they ran blood tests on me and they put me on a gluten-free diet. The plan was while we were waiting for the blood test results to come in, I would follow a gluten-free diet for a week, and after that week, the results should be in, and I would go back to the doctor's office and talk about those test results and how the change in the diet went. Your plan should include a follow-up schedule, so if that first recommendation or test shows nothing, you're going to be back into the doctor's office and you can try something else right away. If they refuse to do more testing, even though you're continuing to experience symptoms, request that they put a note in your file, in your chart, that you requested more testing is done and that they refused it. This will make them think twice about denying you a test just because they think you're too young. I hope that this video has helped you figure out what you should do if you start experiencing symptoms of colorectal cancer. If you want to find out more about the specific symptoms that I experienced before my diagnosis, you can click on the video right up here. Or if you want to find out more about what treatment is like if you are diagnosed with colorectal cancer, you can click on the playlist right down here. Thank you for watching.